inspired you in some way.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Entrepreneur Power Hour. We changed the system up. Now we're doing open discussion about how YouTube videos and movies have introduced your entrepreneurial career and how they have helped yours. So today we have Chris, Giovanni, Doug, Kuba, and Andrew. So anybody want to start with an awesome movie or YouTube video that has really got them going? Give me some awesome stories, guys.
Who wants to go first? Could be anybody.
I guess I'll start it off.
Go ahead, Chrysler. Everybody mute your microphones while Chrysler's talking, please.
Please and thank you. And I don't know if you guys are familiar with the famous Shia LaBeouf video, the Just Do It. Has anybody seen it before? Like, it's very, very recent. But not just videos like that, because obviously it's kind of a funnier version of it, but what I like about YouTube videos these days is I get a lot of inspiration from movies in general. You don't have to be a movie fiend to like films, you know, because whatever it is you watch, it gets into your mind, and eventually you act on what you see. But what I like about films these days is whenever I kind of lose motivation or I need information, I could just go to YouTube, type in one of my favorite guys, and just watch a video. And then just watching that video, I'm like, oh my gosh, like now I'm super inspired. But the Shia LaBeouf one is the one that I was referring to. He just goes, just do it. Nick, you just come true. Just do it. And even though it's funny, it's like, yeah, that's right. I got to just do it. Like, let's go. Man. Things happen. You know, and that's just in the click of a button. Instead of watching cat videos all day, which I really don't do, just a generic example, or watching game videos, and that stuff is not bad, why not get inspired? You know, why not motivate myself to take action? So. Yep. It is a very, very powerful tool, and I think if we use it correctly, I mean, you could be effective in all your areas in business, ministry, whatever it is you're doing. Very powerful.
Yeah, I agree with you. There's some videos I watch regularly. They're game reviews, and it's done by a guy named Angry Joe, and he's funny, right?
Because
he gets so into his role, like into when he reviews bad games, man, does he get mad, and it's entertaining as hell because he tells the truth about how video game companies make terrible games, right? But he's made a career out of doing game reviews. And it's very inspiring to me because that's very entrepreneurial. And when he plays a bad game, he just gets so intense and like he has like a corporate commander costume he wears, and he gets all pissed off and he starts ranting about the game companies and acts out the role of a corporate person who'd be on the phone to the other corporate going, yeah, these guys just bought all our games, ha 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 ha, and we're milking people for their money, ha ha, and it's a terrible game, you know. So that's some pretty funny stuff. I also watch a lot of stuff about, you know, people doing different things, like Tony Robbins. I watch a lot of his stuff, Bob Proctor, and things like that to keep me going, you know, and people just doing cooking shows. I watch a lot of people making stuff on YouTube, like just cooking things or, you know, fixing a lamp. Like you can watch anything on YouTube nowadays. So I think I get inspiration from everything that I watch on there, whether it's metal bands that I like to see performances of, or it's cooking, or it's something artistic, or something humorous. I'm really fond of animals, so I watch a lot of funny cat videos, because cats are pretty funny, especially my cats. They're very, very, they have a very, very, very strong personality, and I should film some cat videos and put them up, because I guarantee you it'd make people laugh so hard, because my cats are pretty crazy, so. Anyway, somebody else, go ahead.
Hey, Chris, I'm going to take a jump on this one really quick. There's a dude on YouTube who also does game reviews, life reviews, and a bunch of different commentary. I'd say he's like a gamer who does social commentary. His name's Boogie. I know you know him, Chris.
Yeah,
I don't know if you guys know him. He was a regular kid who had a really tough life, so he just ate and ate and ate. He got, like, super big. And he makes jokes about it. He'll make crazy videos where people are stealing his Mountain Dew and stuff, and he'll make videos on video games, but he also does social commentary. And one thing he's saying is, he's like, I'm a 40-year-old man. I had a really rough start. I didn't do very well, and he recently just got married and bought a house.
Yep.
And I think he's doing fairly financially well from some of the things. I don't know what he makes, but that's not really the point. The awesome thing about he is, he's crazy, he's funny, but he had one of, some of the roughest start and some of the worst health problems I've seen. That, oh, in speaking of like non-terminal, but he has the ability to accomplish all these things, even in his 40s, which I think he just turned 40. So what that really proves to me is one day he's just saying, go out there and kick life's butt. Really show life that even if you get on a wrong start, that even if things aren't working for you one day, just like I was trying to get on this Hangout, instead of smashing the computer, I've just created a new one and it worked. Don't ask me why, but you need to have that mentality of, I'm going to have fun, I'm going to do crazy things and enjoy life, and no matter what gets in my way, I'm going to kick life's butt. That's what really Boogie has conveyed to me as a YouTuber. He's really funny, and I actually like watching people's videos who have come from maybe a rough start to say, like, hey, my life isn't that bad, I can really do it. It puts things in perspective, because when we just look at successful people all day, it's kind of rough. I'm thinking, what am I doing wrong? But if I look at just a crazy guy who came from basically nothing and has created some awesome stuff like a house or a great marriage, then I know I can do it too.
So
I'd like to hear your guys' personal experiences, YouTube videos, movies. Give me something crazy. Give me something funny. Tell me a good story.
Okay, I would like to cut in.
Go ahead, Andrew.
It's I get sometimes I get really inspired by these X Factor and idols. I don't know how they're all called, but these auditions.
Okay. And
it's really stupid, but I play music, so maybe that's why I have the connection with that. But
cool.
The best part, I think, is when these guys tell their story, you know, when these guys have a horrible life and it's their only chance to get out of the life. There's this girl who lived with her sisters and brothers, seven or eight sisters and brothers, and their mother and grandfather, and I don't know, they live with 15 people in one house, one small house. And then she's on there shaking, like, I'm very scared, but she's doing it, you know?
Yeah.
And then her mouth opens and a voice comes out. It's like, who the hell is that? So good. Everybody is cheering for her. Yeah. The whole audience is going crazy. Yeah. And it gave me goosebumps. And I'm like, wow. It inspires me, man. Just, you know, no matter how scared you are, how in what situation you are, you just need to do something and get out there and that really inspires me.
Right.
I can sometimes, and it's really bad, but I can spend a few hours watching these auditions. But that's one thing that inspires me. I really like it.
Cool. Next person, give us your thoughts. Feedback. Tell us what you've watched that you inspires you.
Okay. This is Doug. I mean, I've watched a lot of stuff on there. I think everybody has. But some of the inspirational videos, like Will Smith and some of the extreme athlete guys. I mean, those are the kind that they just inspire. I mean, it's hard to, or wounded veterans that come back, you know, and do amazing things. It's really impossible not to be inspired, and those are great things to share for extra content when you're doing other stuff on your Facebook page or on your website or whatever, because everybody needs inspiration. I don't care who you are, or where you are, or what you're doing in your life. You know, everybody has those days when they just need something, just pick them up. And one of my big things is veterans. I don't think we honor our veterans and anywhere near as much as we should. So I do a lot of sharing of YouTube videos or anything that shows our heroes, you know, and honoring them. I did actually do one YouTube video of my own. I did that because I tried some program. Can't remember what the program was now, but they asked for a testimonial on it, so I got on there and did a testimonial, and you know, won me a free what was it, Netflix box or something like that. I have no idea what it was, but I did get it in the mail a while later and said, "Yeah, here you go," for helping promote the product by doing a testimonial on it. So there's some ups to it too, but. that's about my whole experience with YouTube. I want to get into it more, but that's one of the things I got to work on still.
Cool. Right on, guys. Giovanni, what movies or YouTube videos have inspired you in your path?
Yeah, so it would be mainly Tony Robbins. He's one of the guys that really inspires you just to take action in anything.
Absolutely.
He is one of the guys that you would just love to go watch seminars and so forth, as well as Les Brown. He's one of the most inspiring person I've ever like heard of, right? Like, the types of words he uses as well. These are probably the best in terms of inspiration for entrepreneurs and so forth, you know?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure.
But yeah, apart from that, that's it.
Oh, yeah. Okay. All right.
Well, I love Les Brown, actually. I'm going to just...
Yeah, whatever. We need free-flowing discussion, so if we interrupt each other, we just stop talking, that's all.
Great, that's right, yeah.
Yeah. Don't worry, guys. If you want to say something, just say it.
Yeah. Say what you want to say.
Yeah. Actually, you know, I love Jim Carrey, and I can't think of anybody who doesn't think he's one of the funniest men in the world. And I watched a video of his recently called Success. And he used to, when he was living in Ontario with his family, they lived out of a van because, you know, his dad lost his job and his mom wasn't working because she was taking care of them. And he used to drive down to an area where he could look out at the horizon, and he kept visualizing being a successful comic. So what he did was he started to go and try out in different comedy clubs where he'd be working, because comedy clubs usually have restaurants where people can buy food or whatever, right? When you're watching shows, you can eat or whatever. And he used to watch the acts when he would bus tables and bring food out and stuff. He'd watch the acts and watch how these comedians interacted with the audience, and he started to write jokes. And he actually started doing stand-up, which I think is incredible. And a movie that he really excelled in that personifying a stand-up comedian was when he played Andy Kaufman in Man on the Moon. And when he did In Living Color, his funniest character is Fire Marshal Bill. And I don't know if you guys have ever seen Fire Marshal Bill, but, you know, just go on there and watch, type in Fire Marshal Bill and laugh your ass off, because I guarantee you will. You know, he makes that crazy face where he like stretches his neck muscles and everything. People think that's makeup. No, that's his real face. And he said he used to get really bad headaches from like doing this the whole time while he was playing the role, right? He'd like stretch his face out and, oh man. And he said that, but he did that, and because he did that, he is now one of the most recognized comedians in the world. And he actually, I don't know if he was ever on Saturday Night Live, but he tried out for Saturday Night Live first, and then I don't know why they didn't want him, but then he met the Wayans brothers, Keenan, Damon, Sean Wayans, and I think there's another one. There's Keenan Ivory, there's Sean Wayans, there's Marlon Wayans, and there's Damon Wayans. So there's four of them. And they started In Living Color, which is one of my favorite shows of all time. I think it's so incredibly hilarious. And I'm really happy that those guys got where they got to go. They're all funny people. And so I think Jim Carrey has a lot of inspiration to offer me as an entrepreneur. And I you know, I can do impersonations really well, I can do voices really well, and I'm not afraid to get in front of a camera. So my mom said, hey, you know, because when I do impressions or I narrate quotes from funny movies I've seen, and I do it, and I tell my mom about it, she says, you should do comedy, because you're so hilarious, Chris, you know, because I can literally reenact scenes in movies that I've seen so well, and I can do the characters pretty well, too, so... That's very inspiring to me. Film and cinema is very inspiring to me as a person, because I think it takes a lot of dedication to stand up and entertain people like that and not be afraid of criticism. So let me know what you guys think about certain other comedies you've seen or other actors that inspire you or actresses or films or whatever.
I'm very, very inspired by Curtis 50 Cent Jackson. And it's funny how that started, man. I'm from Belgium, Brussels. I came to this country when I was 8. And for some reason, I fell in love with hip-hop because just the culture was totally different than what I was used to back in Belgium. But 50 Cent really stood out. And I look at 50 Cent now. I don't really listen to much of his music, if you guys know who that is. But that man is a very intelligent man. Very, very intelligent.
I mean,
not just with Vitamin Water and the movies he's got going on and the new headphones he has, but he's a very entrepreneur-spirited person.
Yep.
And if you look at his story, this man, his mother died when he was 8 years old, you know, and he was sitting in Jamaica, Queens, New York, you know, selling crack when he was 12 years old, all the way up to 19. And I look at his story, especially in my culture, you know, he was supposed to be just another stat, you know.
Right.
End in prison or just die.
Yeah.
But what I like about not just Curtis Peterson Jackson, but regular guys like us, is everybody has a story. It may not be to that extent, but everybody has a story. I'm inspired by the fact that he took responsibility and ability and said, we're still good. But yeah, he doesn't just, can everybody hear me okay?
Yes, we had a server error.
It's all good. We're still here. We're still here. Yeah, but.
Get your shit together, Google.
It's all good.
Hey, guys. It's nice meeting you, all right?
You have to go, Giovanni?
Yeah, I have to go, mate, yeah?
Okay.
All right, man. Have a good one.
Nice meeting you, Giovanni.
Yes, we'll see you again.
Definitely. Take care. Yeah. But
no,
anyway.
We can't see Kareem now. Kareem, where's your camera?
Where's Kareem?
I don't know where Kareem is.
We'll see him back.
All right, keep going, Chrysler.
Yeah, but anyway, I'm just really inspired by those guys because, you know, it's easy to kind of look at them and go, oh my gosh, they got it together, you know, but they're no different from us. They're regular people just like us. They wake up like us. They bleed. They get sick. They're regular people. But I just like the mentality that they have towards any craft they're trying to master. You know, him might be rap or business. Me might be business or ministry. But it shows me I'm not different from this man. And if this man didn't have a mother, you know, got shot 9 times, has been through it and had many setbacks, but still made it, what's my excuse?
No, I grew up
with two awesome players, Kareem, there he is. But just finishing my point here. I grew up with two parents, still happily married. You know, they provide for me, they help me out. So I grew up with a silver spoon. I mean, I had my own issues, I had my own problems. You know, everybody does. Everybody's story has a story. But I look at other guys like that probably didn't have a background or a startup that's much better than mine's, but they still made it to wherever they wanted to make it. So I always look at that and go, well, I have no excuse. Success is just a law. It's something I have to work at. And if I have a stepping stone and this person did it, you know, what's different for me? So that's why I love films. The last movie I saw, actually last night, was The Town. Honestly, anyway, you guys know about that? Ben Affleck and the other actor from that one movie with that one guy. That's a terrible description. the one guy from that one movie.
That's not narrowing it down, bro.
The guy with the face, yeah.
I give that thumbs up.
You guys are gonna have to put your names back up. We lost everybody's names, so people know who we are. Professionalism, right? Anyway, Chrysler. I know who 50 Cent is, and I'm not into hip hop, but yeah, I mean, a lot of these guys that come from the streets of Maryland or LA or Detroit or wherever that get involved in urban music, I mean, for a lot of them, that's their only way out. I mean, so it's not surprising that these guys become very powerful people and very good people growing up in conditions like that. So I can see why that would be very inspiring for you, for sure.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Cool. I think Giovanni mentioned, like, Les Brown, and that for his speech, if you've ever gone on YouTube and heard It's Possible, and he talks about his story. He was born in an abandoned building. He was labeled mentally retarded. He actually failed a couple grades and they pushed him back. And he gives us talk about how he became a professional comedian, how he used to, or a professional speaker, and he says it's possible all the time. And really, if you say that enough, funny enough, like a guy walking around the street, like, it's possible, it's possible. And people, like, looking at him in his car, like, are you okay? Like, yes, it's possible. But literally, not to sound weird, that's motivational and it's funny because it does work, and that's really, really helped me in my life.
Yep.
And I do know 50 Cent. I'm more of a Ludacris, like Tupac type of dude.
Oh, I see.
Like Biggie. I try and keep it old school.
Right.
I think even those guys, like I read up on Tupac, I think a couple months back, and he was an avid reader. He was pretty intelligent.
Oh, yeah.
It was the show. You don't have to go to college, and you don't have to do all these crazy things to be a very intelligent man.
Nope.
He learned a lot in prison, a lot of books. You know, Biggie was just more of a lyricist, but it's the same concept with all those guys, though. I mean, they all just said, this is what I want to do. I want to master this craft. Let's do it. And they all had circumstances that told them, no, just go back to selling crap. You know, they all had different careers. They all went there differently, but it's the same concept, even with us, you know. Our circumstance may be lack of resources. You know, maybe you don't have enough of this or enough of that. But if those guys did it and they got to where they wanted to go, unfortunately, two of them died. But it is what it is. That's beyond the point. We can do it. You know, success is just a law. That's what I've been learning by just watching a lot of guys, reading a lot of books. Even when you watch movies, you know, one of my favorite inspirational movies is Jobs. It's not the best film out there, but I think Ashton Kutcher did a great job playing him. But it just showed how motivated and ambitious he was. That inspires me, because as focused and ambitious as he was, I'm sitting here right now using this man's product, an MacBook Pro.
Yeah.
And I have this man's cell phone. And it shows me, like, I'm not different from that man. If I have that same focus, that same passion for whatever I'm going for, I can achieve it. But I also did learn, it's not really about becoming some important person, you know. That's what I learned from most of those guys. Because a guy like Jobs, he wanted to give value to people. He said, I want to make a MacBook Pro or an iPhone that gives so much value to the user that, you know, they want to keep buying it and buying it and stay loyal to the product. Mm-hmm. And I've learned that it's not about becoming important. It's actually about loving people and starting something that gives so much value, you know, that, you know, you add to, you know, you just add to the positivity of humanity.
Oh, yeah.
So it's very inspiring.
Yep.
Very, very.
I agree with you on Steve Jobs, yeah. And, you know, you look at Bill Gates, I mean, Christ, what OS are we all using right now? Windows? You know, and so many people want to bitch about Windows, and it's like, you know, I'd like to see you make... I'd like to see you make an OS that works on as many different hardware platforms and configurations as Windows. Yeah, if you can do that, be my guest, because it's not easy.
Hey, and what's he doing now? He's helping produce hybrid seeds to grow food for the world. I mean,
that's right. Yep. He's giving back. That's right. And that's what we're all gonna do when we get to where we want to go. You know.
I know. I definitely
absolutely.
You mentioned Bruce Almighty, right, Chris?
No, Yes, man.
Yeah. My bad. No, one movie I've watched.
Yes, man. That's a good one.
That is a good one, isn't it, Andrew?
Yeah.
Just imagine.
I really love that one.
I tried it.
Did you? Did you try saying yes to everything?
Real bad situations, but it was fun.
Oh my
you
god.
You know what? One of the funniest scenes is when he, at the beginning of the movie.
Try it.
Yeah, okay. when he.
I need some water.
One of the funniest scenes at the beginning of the movie when he first gets out of the seminar is when that homeless guy gets in the car with him and he's like, hey, I'm low on money. Can I have some money? He goes, sure, sure you can. And he hands him another one and he goes,
can I have it all?
Can I have it all? And he's like,
oh, my God.
So he gives him all his money and then he says, hey, can I borrow your cell phone? So he's on his phone for like ever talking and talking and talking, right? And then they get up to the top of this like really desolate wooded area, right? And he runs out of gas, his phone dies, and he has no money. And then he's walking down to get his gas, right? And he's like, hey, do you want to give all your money to a homeless guy and let him run out your cell phone battery so you can't call AAA? That sounds like a fucking great idea! He's so freaking pissed off, right? Yeah. Oh, man, it was awesome. See, that's Jim Carrey, though. He's so energetic. It's so funny. Oh, I love him so much, man. Oh.
Well, that was the point I was trying to make. No, that's what we should do. Instead of being entrepreneurs, I'm just going to go on the street corner after this and be like, hey, can I have a dollar? Can I have another one? The next guy's like, go away.
They have a lot of people in the next big corner doing that already, Kareem.
Yeah, we got a lot of people panhandling already, man.
And most of them are making as much as we are, guys.
It's an official career.
Well, it's a shot. The one thing I really like in that movie is when he says he's trying to do that prayer, there's like one speck of kindness can change the world. And he starts giving back. And I can really see that Morgan Freeman's like the awesomest actor ever. I don't know if that's a word, awesomest.
Don't worry about
it. It is now.
It is now. Awesomest. We're gonna patent that.
We're gonna start a new term.
Write that down.
I'm gonna put down an urban dictionary.
We should patent that word in our book we're writing.
Awesomeness.
Yeah, we should patent that word.
Marty's great.
Entrepreneur power hour ever.
Yeah.
Oh my god. Hashtag awesomeness.
Hashtag awesomeness. Yeah. But seriously, just one small act of kindness to give back that Morgan Freeman says, and then he actually makes a prayer. He's like, here, tell me a prayer. He's like, feed the sick, feed the hungry. And he's like, no, say a real prayer. And he's like, I hope this woman can find someone who treats her and then do like the right thing. And he's like, that to me is a prayer.
Yeah, and then he gets his wife back. Yep.
You know, you just talked about that one moment of kindness, and I think I just posted like yesterday on my own Facebook page a little video where it starts with a construction worker helping a guy, like he drops his bike, crashes or something, helps him up, and then that kid turns around, walks down the street, and he helps somebody do something, and then that person helps the next person, and it comes big all the way around, full circle.
Yep.
The construction worker getting a nice cold glass of water from a waitress, you know, and it's like, you know, this is the way God designed the world to be in the first place before it was all screwed up by sin. So that's, you know, but if everybody did that, can you imagine what the world would be like, you know?
Yeah, it'd be great. Like, honestly, as an entrepreneur, one of the reasons I'm doing that, I don't want to see as much conflict, as much problems between cultures, races, religions. I really want to see random acts of kindness. And another one, and actually Andrew showed me this one, so I'm going to describe it and go over it with him as well. There's this blind guy, right? And he says, I'm blind, I need help, I need some change, something like that. It's a power of words, you can look it up. And people are putting change in his little thing, so I guess he's doing my entrepreneur career already. But a woman walks by and then changes a sign, and you start to see more money come in. You don't see what the sign says, and he asks, like, what did you do to my sign? He's like, I did what you wanted to do. I just changed the lettering. And she changed it to, it's a beautiful day. I can't see it. And the what I mean, that really got me here, and it's kind of funny how just changing signs on the words can increase donations. What do you think of that, Andrew? Because you're the one who showed me that.
Yeah, it's really powerful. It's an old movie. There's an update also on it. I found it somewhere. Part two.
Cool.
It's about the power of words, and if you think about it, the power of words is really powerful. It's just how you say something to somebody, and the sign said, "I'm blind, please help." And this guy got one quarter, and then 5 minutes later, there's another one giving some money, and this woman changes the sign, and people are throwing money at him, and he's swimming in, no, not swimming, but as right an on. Example, a lot of money comes in his pocket, and then you see the sign, and it basically says the same, but in a different way, where people can feel his pain. Because it's a beautiful day,
but I can't
see it, and people,
you just feel it.
You know what I mean? And I think in business it's the same. It's you know, there are a lot of people don't get many customers or you have problems with. But if you look at the words you're using and change them, you can change things. You turn everything around.
Yep. It's the power of language, man. The power of language. Yep. Absolutely.
You can say a nice thing to a person, and the person can be. It's possible that the person is not affected by what you say. But if you say the same compliment but in a different way, somebody can shine. And, wow! It's just how you say it.
Yep.
You know, it's interesting about that, Andrew. I had a conversation with a friend yesterday about like being too needy towards people. Like, you know those guys, it's like you want to talk to a woman or even just people in general, you know, you want to form relationships, but it's like everything that person says and does, they seem so needy, you know, it push them away, like, okay, yo, chill, okay, I hear you. But I think when you have this sense of, like, wholeness and you mean what you say, even in business, especially in network marketing, because you can try to market something, but you come across so needy and pushy, like, I need people, I need 10 people to make this much money. It pushes people away automatically. But say you have zero customers or zero people in your business, but you have this sense of wholeness, like, you know, like you say, it's a beautiful day. I'm trying to think of an example, like, oh, our business is booming, you know, thank God, and I'm a successful person looking for other successful people. Let's make money together. It's like, yeah, that's right, darn it. Let's do it, you know. And I just believe, you gotta definitely believe what you say. You know, you gotta be first.
Yeah, you do. If you don't believe in what you say, people feel it. People see it.
Yeah, they feel it too. Especially,
well, you know, I'm very successful, and you.
you know what I find?
People say, hey,
it's like, fuck off. No, you're not.
Yeah.
if you were, why would you be on Facebook spamming groups going, I need more people? Like, what are you doing?
Like, people sense that. People are not stupid, man.
No, and that's why I'm so glad that me and Kareem and Chrysler got educated in the program we did get educated in.
Yes, but sir.
It's very, very hard. There's a lot of things about that program that we also didn't jive with. So now we're off doing our own thing. We've grown wings. Well, your guys' would be, I don't know, my wings would be black, huge bat wings, but, you know.
Batman over here.
Batman
is but,
I just ordered some chicken wings.
You're like, did somebody say wings? No, not those wings.
Kareem, we're not talking about chicken
not those
wings, bro.
Wait, what?
Oh, this is good. All of our hangouts should be. Yes,
what are you going to do when you become successful? Have fun. Have more fun.
Yeah.
Except we'll probably be on the beach doing this. Like, hey, check out that wave.
No, you know what we're all going to be doing? We're all going to be sharing a big, huge case of beer. That's what we're going to be doing. We're all going to be shit. And you know, me and if you guys don't want to drink, fine. Then me and Andrew will drink, and we'll make complete asses of ourselves on the beach, hitting on women. You know, that's all my. That's fine.
That's
I can do it.
Yeah, because it'd be like, here's a motivational speech from Chris and Andrew. Yeah. Hey, baby, how you doing?
It's like, Black Way. He's like, what are they talking
Here's
about?
Here's a funny thing. Honestly, that could fit into another movie, a Fight Club type of context, where he's just sick of his corporate job. Like
Great
someone
film.
Like, I know, Office Space Corp, and he just leaves and goes does fun stuff in
yep.
Office Space. In Fight Club, he does something... Not like fun, but he does something like getting in fights. And I used to think that movie was just about punching people. It's not. It's about a guy finding his innermost desires and realities by hitting rock bottom and then coming back up again by doing what he really feels passionate about.
Yeah.
Just being and in Office Space, I think it's interesting when he leaves the office for a while, they want to promote him. And I honestly think I'm not like saying like guys leave your job it'll be cool, but I honestly think the stuff I'm doing away from the office when I do leave the office if I ever come back they'll be like oh Kareem you did this and that and I'll have the Hawaiian T-shirt on I'll be sitting there they'll be like really should we promote this guy to manager it's like he doesn't have skills no he has fun he enjoys his life that's what this should be about.
Yep.
And movies are one way to do that. A good movie or a good YouTube video can inspire you to be an entrepreneur, especially if it's Eric Thomas.
I'll tell you that probably the most inspiring true story I've ever seen in a movie was it's an older movie. It's called Breaking All the Rules. You guys ever heard of that?
Oh yeah, with Jamie Foxx.
The story of the guys that invented Trivial Pursuit.
Okay.
And talk about, I mean, you never heard the backstory of that. I mean, these guys, it's just three guys, all married, had homes, you know, had wives and houses and mortgages and everything else. And they came up with this idea, and they tried to promote it, and they had ended up with all of their homes with second mortgages and being, you know, literally ready to take it away. One guy was to the point, he was so stressed out that he had a heart attack. You know, these guys, their wives were against them, their friends were against them, everybody saying, you guys are nuts, you got to give this up. And they stuck with it, ended up finally getting in front of, I think it was Mattel.
Yep.
And got the largest upfront royalty and royalty package of any game in the history of mankind.
Yep.
And the very closing scene... is after all, I mean, the whole movie is all their struggle, you know, where they're just going through, I mean, literally living hell. And at the very end, though, it shows them on a giant yacht in the middle of a big ballroom with chandeliers everywhere, and they're standing in the middle of it, and they just all lift their little champagne glasses and say, we made it, and just clink their glasses, and that was the end of it. But
wow.
Talk about just... I mean, just grabbing you by the throat and shaking you around and saying, don't ever give up, man. No, just don't.
That's right. Nope.
Yeah.
I would nope.
You can make a list of all the movies and put it on the website.
Yeah, we could do that. Yeah, we could totally do that.
I've got another one. Does anybody have ever seen Pay It Forward?
Pay It Forward? No, I haven't.
None of that.
That's a really great movie.
Yeah? Cool.
Yeah,
okay.
It's I forgot the actor, but it's a teacher, and he gives an assignment to his class, children from I don't know 10, 12 years old or something.
Right.
And he says, come up with an idea, a small thing that you can do to change the whole world.
Cool.
And one of these kids, he makes something up, Pay It Forward, and his idea is to do something for three people, something they can do themselves, something they need help with, or whatever.
Yep.
And instead of paying somebody back, the guys he, or the girls he helped need to do to three other people.
Oh, wow.
And then you see in the movie, the teacher says, well, it's a great idea, you need to do it, and he does it. He helps three people, and he tells them the same. And then after a while, he doesn't notice anything that something is happening, so he thinks he's failed. But in the meantime, the good deeds to others are spreading around states in America, but goes to Europe, and it goes really fast. So it's like the pyramid, you know?
Yes. Yep.
It's,
you notice too that the first guy that he approached or that he did a favor for was somebody that, you know, was at the end of his rope. I think he was a drug addict or alcoholic or something like that, but real down on his luck, living probably homeless. And, you know, the just the kind of person that you would be most, or, you know, most people would be least likely to help right off the bat. And he picked him above everybody else and said, I don't care who you are or where you're at, let's help you out. And all I ask is that you do the same.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't ask any better than that.
Nope.
You know, how I got the movie, well, I met somebody. A guy, and he's also a public speaker, and he does seminars and everything. And I spoke to him once, and he got my address or something. And he said, here, I want you to have, and he gave me the DVD. He said, here, watch this. This is cool. I never saw the guy again, but he just gave me the DVD, and I saw it, and I was really inspired.
It was an angel. It was really cool.
And did you give the DVD to three other people?
Yeah, both three gave it away. but I always.
Andrew, you're awesome.
I always like to help other people.
Yes.
Oh, absolutely.
That's what that's about.
No,
I think it always comes back. I mean, like Zig Ziglar, I used to watch his videos, and he said the number one, I think, psychology thing by this psychologist dude, I don't remember his name, is gratitude. Being grateful for what you have.
Yep.
And he talks about this lady and says, I'm guilty of. And he says, okay, I can help you. Just take out a piece of pen and paper. And she, like, hesitates to do it. And then he says, I can't help you. In 90% and 100% of the cases I've seen, people don't take step one. Never take step two. So pull out your paper and write down, I like my job because. She's like, I don't like anything about it. And he asks, well, do you do it for benevolent reasons or do they pay you? And he's like, well, they pay me. He's like, so you don't like to get paid. And then to elaborate more, she writes it down. And then later on he finds, like, there's 23 things she liked, but she was just being so negative, and she wasn't grateful for anything. I think when you give back to people, when you pay it forward three times, when you help three people, that just increases the people who are going to come and help you. When you work with three people and really inspire them on a daily basis, they'll inspire three people.
Right.
And you'll really create a real revolution. And now we can do that through YouTube and movies, which is one reason I wrote this, because now it's very powerful. Somebody from another country can watch something and become a fan of me.
Yep.
Yeah, you know, what else you see around you is some people say, well, I don't have any money and I don't have the power to help other people. But for some, you know, you can help somebody with a lot of money, but you can also help somebody just by, you know, helping them out in the garden again sometimes, yep. or giving somebody a sandwich, you know?
Yep.
I was walking in the airport in Dusseldorf, and there was this guy, he was in the garbage searching for food or something, I don't know. And I was there, I just bought a sandwich, and I saw this guy, I said, hey man, do you like a sandwich? And I said, let's go. And we went to the bakery, and I pick one. And it's just, you know, it's fun. It's I can do it, so why not? Wow. It's just a sandwich. But this guy was he was happy. He was like, ah, great.
Yeah.
And it gave me a good feeling. He was happy, and you know, the feeling that you can give other people.
Yes.
With a real small
gesture.
Small thing, a small gesture.
Yeah.
Right. Also,
it's
little thing.
Priceless.
I got a testimony similar to yours, Andrew. Literally a couple months ago, it was for the school I go to where we're doing mission trips. But I was a team that stayed in Atlanta, so we just did random acts in Atlanta. And this one particular day was actually titled Random Acts of Kindness. Yeah, because I had trouble saying it right for some strange reason during that time. But it actually was what it was. Everybody was split into three groups, and it was four guys in my group. And we just had to come up with things that we would do the whole day for random acts. One idea was, and this was actually mine, I was like, hey, I want to write a poem, you know, because I love lyrics, I love wordplay. I want to write a poem, and then I want to show up to Walmart and perform it to a random person that works there just to make them feel awesome. And I'm like, let's do it. So after other acts of kindness, I get there. Man, if I still had the lyrics memorized or if I had the paper, I would tell it to you guys. But, you know, just a random guy, you know, I'll walk in there like, okay, you know, I'm looking around. My friend goes, do him, you know, random worker, you know, black guy, had tattoos, look like a, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm like, let's do it. So I walk up. I'm like, how you doing, my good friend? He's like, what's up? I'm like, hey, man, no crazy agenda. I just want to perform this poem because you're awesome and you're really important. And he's like, you know, like his face lit up, you know. And then I tell him the poem, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da- like, yeah, man, you're awesome. Like, you deserve that. And, you know, we walked off, and that was that. But I just remember, I mean, that one thing, you know, I didn't expect anything neither. If you would have rejected me, I would have been like, whatever, I still got love for you. But just, you know, being fully there, giving this guy a random poem. How many times does that even happen anyway? I mean, imagine how you would feel, Angel, or anybody else on here. If you're going on a quit trip, somebody stops you and goes, hey, I don't know you, sir. And look at you in the eye and say, I just want to say you're awesome and you matter. Today is going to be a great day for you. I mean, that would give you a pretty good impression because people don't do that nowadays.
No.
So doing that for him, God knows what that did for him the rest of the day, the rest of the week, probably his whole year, you know. So it was, and I felt great too, you know, that's what it's all about. But another thing I did learn when it comes to that, especially in this country, I think we always expect things back, and that's why we get disappointed when we do things like that. Because I'm the kind of guy, man, I go to the mall, Walmart, somebody's getting blessed, whether it's a hello, a conversation, or what's up, or God loves you, or no matter what it is. It's natural to me now. But some people would just say hi to somebody, and the other person doesn't say anything. They just keep walking. And they'll go, dude, that was awkward, man. I'd be like, now I understand why they feel that way. But it's like, if you truly love somebody, want to give value, it doesn't matter what happens after that. You know, because if you just really give something, if you give a value, no matter what happens, you're going to get that back, even if it's not from that person. That's what I believe from my experience, you know. So same being an entrepreneur, man. I mean, you're just going out, you're just giving your value, giving your idea, giving your energy. Some people will reject it. They will reject it. But if your motives are pure, you know, if you don't have a motive to feel important, if your motive is actually to help people and give them value, you're going to find those people that will receive that. And you'll get more of that yourself.
Yeah. I have a little thing myself, just really quick. Well, I have two really quick ones. One is, as you know, I try and post positive stuff because I see a lot of people who don't post. I mean, I'm not saying any of you guys, but there's a lot of people who post a lot of negative things on Facebook. My ex did this. Right. My job is this. My car. And after a while, it gets old. Or they'll post something that really is. So I started to post things that I found positive. Maybe being a little rebellious in my own sense. And the lunch lady who worked with me, who I just added on Facebook, said, man, I didn't expect that from your Facebook post. She's like, why? Or I'm like, why? And she said, because you're always goofy and stuff, and I really didn't think you would be posting. I'm like, I just do that because for fun, and I like it. She's like, you really do put some positive energy on Facebook. And another time was when I was walking to work. I used to work at a bank, and I really did not have fun there. But I saw two homeless guys, and he's like, you know, I need some money. I think he wanted to get some food. And I gave him some money, and then I started talking to the guy, and I said that, you know, you'll be all right, just look for the right thing. And then he asked me what I meant. And I said, it's kind of funny, if you really, not in a weird way, but if you really want something or look for something, focus on something, it will appear. It will appear to you. And he just said, like, you know, one day I said I wanted to find fresh fish, and I walked down, and then there's fresh. So it does work. To take time out of your day to make somebody feel a little bit better, you never know. Maybe they hit the lottery the next day, like, Kareem, you're the man, you're my best buddy, here's a bunch of...
Yeah.
So that's something to do with YouTube movies or videos, but I think it should be brought up that we can all do that. And I did see, I don't know, Andrew, did you give me a video? I think it was a guy who orders pizza, or he wants a slice of pizza, and he's in this restaurant, and all these well-dressed people are like, no, you can't have it. Then he asks this homeless guy, can I have a slice of pizza?
And oh, like, yeah.
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 The homeless guy, he was laying there, he just got $10 from somebody or something. And the other guy, it was a setup, but
yes,
the homeless guy didn't know that.
Yeah,
and the homeless guy just gave him $5 or $8 to get a bite or something.
Yes, I've seen that.
That was awesome. That's
really I know.
There are several of them like that. It's always the people that have the least that are always the most willing to.
That's right.
There.
Yep.
But you know the gesture. I did a test once because I love to smile, and I did a test one. If you only smile at somebody, they completely change.
Oh, yeah.
I was walking on the street, and there was this girl coming towards me with two bags of groceries in her hand. She was like looking down. And she was, oh, it was heavy, you know. And I walked up to her, and I just smiled at her, and for some, I don't know why, but she looked up, and she was looking normal, but she saw my face, she saw me laughing, and she started smiling, and you saw her lit up.
Yeah.
Walking straight, and she walked on. It was really funny to see, just smiling to somebody.
Yeah.
It was real fun.
Since we're on the movie venue here, the movie Patch Adams.
Oh, yes.
He drops down from the tree in front of the old lady and smiles at her and
moves
away, and he says, just wait for it. And then she turns back and smiles a couple of seconds later. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's such a great movie. And, you know,
I wish I could do what he did, where you could, you know, make a random phone call and just talk to somebody for 3 hours. I've never been able to do that kind of stuff, but
just do it then.
Just do it.
Nothing stopping you, buddy.
Right. Yeah. Just do it. That's right.
Nothing stopping you, buddy.
That's true.
Yeah, and you know what I really liked about Robin Williams, and rest in peace, Robin, you know. But one thing I really liked in that movie was how he constantly was challenging the establishment of allopathic medicine. And they didn't want him to do talking and Reiki therapy and all this alternative stuff to these dying kids. And it's like, that's what happens when someone's profession gets so locked into their subconscious and into all their being that they think, from all that programming they learned in school and through the system of becoming a doctor, they think there's no other alternative than pharmaceutical treatments or drug therapy or traditional medicine. And that, you know, I'm going to get in trouble for saying this, but I don't care. The allopathic industry is a joke. Pharmaceuticals are the worst things you can put in your body. Anything that has a name that I don't recognize, I don't put that in my body. Because chemicals do not work with your body's natural healing agents. okay?
Knock, knock.
Then I hope you can smell, you can spell apple.
Yeah, A-P-P-L-E, yeah.
Chris, knock, knock. It's the FDA.
Yeah.
The like pharmaceutical. We heard you wanted to cure.
Not meant to treat, cure, diagnose, or prevent any disease.
Yeah,
like, just to make sure everybody knows that's going on.
Right? Yeah, or when you see those commercials for, like, you know, these blood pressure medications, right? And you see, like, this guy with his dog and the wife, and they're all happy, but then you hear this drug may cause all the side effects such as gastrointestinal bleeding or frequent urination, or you may have sore bones or blah blah. It's like, oh my god, why?
It's subliminal, man. By the time you get done watching the commercial, you feel so good from seeing the dog and the kids.
You don't even hear the side effects anymore.
Hey
guys,
I don't care about that.
Get some Tylenol and some Zoloft.
Oh man, that's horrible.
Does anybody want any? I'm going to get some Tylenol and Zoloft. I feel inspired now. Some of you dancing in a field. That scares me actually. Restless leg syndrome has a medication that has death as a side effect.
Yeah, I know, right?
Should I? It's like, come on now.
What the hell are people thinking? Yeah, I'm gonna go.
We become dependent, you know.
Yeah.
We become dependent. I don't believe medicine is bad to an extent, but since we're talking about films, I love documentaries as well. That's very helpful. That's very helpful. Very helpful.
I'm hearing an echo. Someone's got their speakers.
Yeah. I don't know who that is. Is it better now? Anybody here?
Yeah.
Yes, I don't hear.
I did. Yeah, it was really bad.
Yeah, anyway. I heard it earlier too. But I saw a documentary. It was actually talking about them.
I can hear it still here. Yeah, really bad.
I guess everybody just mute themselves for now. That way, it's not an issue.
I guess we can try that.
Yeah. That's better.
Is that better? Yeah, somewhat. But I saw it was called American Pills. You know, something similar to that title. It was on Netflix actually. And my father, he has a gout, so he takes prescription here and there for it. And one day I went to the dentist. This was a couple years ago. I went to the dentist for the first time. I had the tooth taken out. I mean, they gave me hydrocodone and a bunch of other stuff, you know, just for my tooth. And I'm not going to say it was their fault that I got a little bit addicted to it, because when I was already, you know, smoking pot, I was deep into that stuff anyway. But it's just, it's so easy, man, to get addicted to that stuff. But 90% of the time, and I will say 90% of the time, because I see it in my dad, all you really have to do is eat correctly and eat healthy. But somehow there's something about these medicines. They do help. They put the pain away for a long while. But then your body becomes so addictive to it.
Oh, yeah.
By the time you stop, you start getting these, you know, you start getting withdrawals and things of that nature. And you keep taking it, keep taking it. And it may not be to get high or anything like that. But eventually, 5 years later, 10 years later, now you got liver problems. Now you can barely pee. Now your brain's hurting. Now you have itchiness on up the neck. You know, you just have all this crazy stuff. So we become dependent, man. I'd even challenge people sometimes, and I do this for myself. The last time I took a Tylenol, it's been a while. Unless I have like a major headache and I have things to do, I'll take a Tylenol. I don't believe medicine is that bad. But sometimes watch what you eat. Just try watching what you eat. Since we're talking about movies, Food Inc., if you guys have ever seen that one, that's on Netflix too. That's really opened my eyes to the things I put in my body. I'm not like an extreme vegetarian, or I'm not even a vegetarian, but I'm not like an extreme diet person. But I do know 90% of the time if I feel sick or get headache, just because I'm not eating correctly. But I think we've idolized medicine because of our lack of responsibility. And now even we get all these crazy syndromes and all these symptoms, and now we just keep making more medicine. Like, it's insanity.
Yeah. It is.
You know, so it's very interesting. So I think, too, it's good to watch movies and things like that, but documentaries, man, I mean, it's information. They tell it like it is. They expose things. And when you get that knowledge, it's your responsibility to do something with that knowledge. Because you can watch a cool documentary and tell all your friends about how smart you are. Hey, man, we put this in our body, we put this, we put that. if you're not applying it, you know, it really doesn't matter.
No, that's right.
Believe me, you can end up being called the food police. I've been guilty of that.
That's scary.
Trying to tell my wife.
No, here's a funny thing. Do you all know Elliot Hulse? He's like this really jacked bodybuilder dude who gives people advice on YouTube.
No.
And he said Okay, cool. You know Alec Holst. I watch a video, and he's like, it's not that hard, guys. Health is not that hard, provided you don't have, like, a condition. He's like, sleep, eat real food, drink water. I'm like, he's like, there's no money, I guess, in telling people. I'm not saying medication's useless, but a lot of people will do that as a default. I don't think there's enough people saying, eat, like, fruits and vegetables, eat real food, drink water, go to sleep on time. Don't stress out constantly. I know your job's important, but these are simple things we can do regardless of any doctors or any treatments or even getting any alternative treatments. I can't say I've never been sick, but generally when I eat pretty healthy, I eat home-cooked meals, I don't drink or smoke, I feel really good.
Right.
And I do believe this is possible.
Oh, yeah. And so sure. Unfortunately, a lot of people don't understand how much bad stuff is in the food you can find. You know, if you're not buying organic, if you're not buying unprocessed stuff, unfortunately, people just don't know about it. And then, of course, it's so hard to find the stuff without spending a fortune anyway. So it's a long road back. But you mentioned something there about the documentaries and stuff. One of the things that's changed with YouTube, especially, and I see this as being a really valuable tool for society, is the fact that anybody, I mean, it doesn't matter who you are, if you've got something to say, you actually have a voice now.
Yep.
You know, I mean, I've seen people that obviously have never made a video in their life, but they get up there and they have something important to say, and they say it in a way that resonates with people, and it goes everywhere, you know?
Yep.
Especially, I think one of the places that's made a biggest difference, or a very big difference now, a lot of people are, it's a touchy subject, but in politics. I mean, it used to be you got your news and you heard what's going on, and that was it, you know. But now if people are delving in behind the scenes on things and all this stuff that's coming out all over the backgrounds of people and all the transparency issues and all the distrust and everything, if it wasn't for the internet and the, you know, and people talking about it on videos and people talking about it on social media, half of that stuff would still be hidden and nobody would know anything about it. And, you know, at least in my opinion, this is a turning point, and we hopefully have caught some of this at the right point in time to keep us from losing our country here. But it's a lot of times it's just somebody small that has an issue, a personal story that they share, and it goes everywhere. You know, that's great.
Mm-hmm. One thing actually I watched in congruency with that, Doug, and I'm not really going to give an objective opinion on it, but it was interesting, was Edward Snowden was talking to people from Russia on this like little robot that turns. It was kind of weird. It's like a monitor with wheels on it. And one thing he said that we, like younger generations and older generations and all, is to protect the rights of the internet so anybody who, like you said, didn't have a voice can get up there and can be allowed to express themselves how they want to. And that's not just, in my opinion, a one country and American thing. That's everybody, because now we have the ability to inspire people as entrepreneurs. And I love that freedom. So I think we need to utilize that as possible. I used to have a limiting belief that YouTube's narcissistic. Oh, I don't want to make videos about myself. But it really does work. It really does work, especially when I believe there was this famous, I can't remember his name, her name. I watched this like famous YouTuber. She actually used YouTube to sit to express that, like, I guess she was coming out. I think her name's Ingrid Nielsen or something. I can't remember the name. But regardless of that, people now have a voice through a camera. And it's the awesomest thing ever. Now I can look into a camera and I can empower myself and tell people my story. And if you look at these, like, Write My Life, like when famous YouTubers do, it's really introspective. It's really awesome.
Sure, and there's abuses to it, you know, all over the place too. But you know, you can't exchange abuse for freedom, that's for sure.
I would rather have freedom than be worried about, because there's a few people, yeah, I'm sure, who make bad YouTube videos.
Right.
But at the end of the day, I still want the ability to do it. I still want the ability to be shown in the world. I don't think we should ban things. But
I mean, the stuff with ISIS going on and all their social media recruiting and everything, that's a really tough call, whether to restrict that or allow it. But, you know, I mean, there's got to be a line somewhere.
Oh, yeah.
It makes that line scary, you know.
Yeah. I'm more of a, like, free market type dude. My idea is that you let freedom work, like Benjamin Franklin. I've watched a lot of YouTube videos. That if you let freedom work, if you let people do their own thing, like entrepreneurs like us, they'll find a way to fix the world. We'll find it's not going to be another sovereign. It's not going to be someone necessarily banning. Like, take this for instance. Let's say I don't want people taking Zoloft and Tylenol, and I know it does bad stuff to your liver. Instead of saying to Congress, ban this, I take the time out of my day to make a YouTube video, to get good video editors, and to say, hey, this is the problem with what's going on here. Like, have you guys ever seen Super Size Me? I'm not saying...
Yes, incredible movie.
Great movie.
That opened my eyes. I'm like, no McDonald's ever again. Even
maybe
though
more McDonald's or something.
I was just thinking about it. But I had friends who were like, let's go to Mickey D's. Now I'm like, supersize me.
That's a good example, though. That's a great example for him. You know, yeah, I feel the same way, honestly. When I'm banning, you know, YouTube or, like, you know, rights to say whatever you want, do whatever you want on the internet, it's not really going to solve the issue. I mean, I think it's not even YouTube or the internet. It's just people.
Yeah, people are going to do it one way or another.
Yeah, exactly. It's how you use it. If you use it for good, and yeah, if you use it for bad, but it's not the internet, it's just people.
Yeah, you know? And market forces will usually stop something that people don't want. Mm. You know.
Yeah.
But we, as a country, we can't exchange safety for freedom. We can't exchange freedom for safety. We need the freedom more than we need the safety, I think.
Mm. I think you get safety out of freedom, because then somebody will say, man, I don't feel really safe. What do we do? Let's get on a Google Hangout and talk about it. We're, you know, if we're in different things. And then, okay, everybody's laughing at me now.
Oh, you're right. Look at gun control laws. Every time they try to control gun use, those areas are the least safe. You know, it's just... If they just let people take care of themselves, usually things are taken care of. I mean, you just got to let
entrepreneurs are an awesome example of that. If you say, like, hey, Timmy, here's a computer, go change the world, he usually does it. And you're like, Timmy, here's all the things you can't say on YouTube, you can't make these type of jokes, or you can't be goofy, then there's the problem. So I say with YouTube, with movies, one movie that really comes to mind, or one YouTube channel that really comes to mind. I lost it.
Uh-oh.
Actually...
You should have seen your face.
It really comes to mind, huh?
It came to mind, and I lost
it. You got it. It's going to come back.
Oh, what was it? Oh, thank you. Thank you for not smoking. Actually, it is a movie. It's about a tobacco lobbyist.
Yeah.
Here's an interesting thing. We all know cigarettes are... I'm not a big fan of smoke. If you smoke, that's fine. But here's an interesting thing. He's a lobbyist for it, and he's going around telling people, like, how do you know cigarettes aren't bad? My mom said it. And the funny thing is that he ends up, you know, they give him too much nicotine, and then he starts going against the grain. So instead of saying we ban cigarettes... Let someone, I'm not saying we should let people, like, in bad experiences, but sometimes it's necessary, and then they come out and say, this is wrong. I'll be an example why this is wrong. And that's a power of media.
True.
Yeah.
Let's not talk about lobbyists. That could go on for a long time.
I kind of don't like this political stuff at all. Because I'm not political in any sense of the term.
Back to the movies.
Yeah, movies.
Hashtag awesomeness.
No, opening up discussions about whatever needs to be discussed is the way to get it solved, not any of the banning stuff. That's ridiculous.
Yeah, it is. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Awesome.
So, what other movies? I mean, another movie. There's a lot of movies I've seen that have been really inspiring to me. There was one I saw a couple years back called. Oh God, I watched so many movies. Oh, I can't think of it either. Oh, well, whatever.
The Menace to Society?
That's probably one of them. But, no, that's more of an urban reality film. I really like movies like that, too. Like, black urban reality films are very powerful movies.
Dazed and Confused?
Pardon?
Dazed and Confused?
Now, that's a good one, yeah.
It is, though.
That's a really funny movie, actually.
That was my time growing up, man.
I'm 34, so I'm pretty getting up there too, you know. But,
me too.
You're 27.
Right.
What are you talking about? You're young.
It's like 18. I got a cane and so
scary. I'm twice your guy's age. Come on. Have you ever seen the movie The Gift? No, that looks like
a really good one. I saw that when I went to the movie theater to see Mad Max Fury Road. By the way, that's incredible, Doug. If you like the old Mad Max movies, the remake from George Miller is amazing. I've seen it 3 times.
Unfortunately, my greatest talent in the world is apparently remembering every movie and every actor and every actress in them.
Oh, wow.
And that's why that is. It's absolutely worthless.
Oh, that's wicked.
Wow.
But, if I could have that same talent in other ways, I would probably be far, far better off. But for some reason, that's what sticks. So, yeah, I remember Mad Max.
I had a friend like that.
Yeah, the new Mad Max movie is amazing. I haven't seen anything that good from Hollywood in probably a long time. A long time.
Well, the Gift is a little on the of the spectrum.
Yeah, it's a psychological thriller. I saw the preview for that. Yeah, it looks good.
The Gift, the one I'm talking about, is called The Gift. It's a story of a very rich guy, trust fund kid.
Yeah.
His heir or his great grandfather dies and has a fortune, like billions, and tells him he's going to inherit it all, but he has to go through some tests, basically.
Okay.
And he goes, and in the process of going through this, he meets a young girl that's dying of cancer.
Oh, yes, yes,
and,
okay.
It sounds like one of these touchy-feely, boring movies, but I'll tell you what, it's really very entertaining and very thought-provoking. But without giving the story away, his life, it shows how his life has changed completely by the gift this little girl gives him, and where he takes his life from there. And it's, believe me, for anybody that wants to help other people or has that desire in their heart, this is a movie you got to see.
Yeah. Yep.
Wow. For me, actually, that reminded me of another movie I like, Trading Places with Ben Affleck and Eddie Murphy.
Yeah, that was an incredible movie. Really funny, too. It's Dan Aykroyd, not Ben Affleck. It's Dan Aykroyd.
I've never heard of Ben Affleck and Eddie Murphy in a film.
Well, you know, it could be. I'll try it.
Nah, Kareem, you're too young.
Ben Affleck could do the remake.
That would be terrible then. Ben Affleck's a terrible actor.
Oh, he's good. You guys need to stop hating. I saw Argo yesterday, by the way.
What's your problem? But no, it shows how actually based on wealth, people will cater their actions. It's not based on any class or any society. It just shows that dude, when they trade places, will actually do the same bad stuff as the guy who's desperate, which is interesting because a lot of people will point to when something bad happens that it's because this person's from here, here, there. And I really think it just economic status drives the majority of people's behavior. That's what
Yeah, that's the question between environment and influence. You know?
Absolutely.
Or, I mean, genetics and environment.
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah, you know, I can think of a number of films I've seen with that have had really incredible stories where, you know, there's all this trial and tribulation, but at the end of the movie, everybody always comes out better than they started. And I think that we got to remember that no matter how bad something gets, it's always going to work out in the best way possible. Because when something goes down in your life, there's always something coming up, right? Because we live in a universe where balance is the biggest law. It is the probably the most powerful of the 11 laws would be balance, and also reciprocation. So every time you sacrifice something, the law of compensation will come into effect. Every time you are compensated, then you're required to sacrifice. So then the law of balance shifts in, and it all works out. I mean, so I just think that we just need to understand that the more we do stuff for people, and the more that we are on here together, interacting, having fun, you know, we could have just made somebody's day. It says zero viewers down there in the corner, which I'm kind of disappointed about. But
it did say two before, a couple minutes ago.
You know, so, but I mean, you know, Marsha, our mentor, Marsha Sortino, says, well, your show's too long. People, well, you know what? This is what we do. And if people, we're going to find the people that will watch a two-hour program. If we want to talk for 2 hours, we're going to talk for 2 hours. And we're going to find the people that have exactly the same drive that we have to be here for 2 hours. Do you guys understand what I mean? So I don't think it's important that we tailor to those microwave generation minds. I think we need to tailor to the people who want that the inspiration and the wisdom that we all offer one another and absorb and give and take. And so, I mean, I say we just keep doing an hour or 2 hours. If people don't like it, well, whatever. You know,
curious about those 11 laws you got there. I'd like to see that. I've never heard of that before.
11 what?
The 11 laws.
Oh, the 11 laws, 11 forgotten laws by Bob Proctor. Yes, look up Bob Proctor, the 11 forgotten laws of the universe.
Type it into the...
Yeah, I will.
Yeah, check that out, man.
You just got to Google it.
I didn't understand the name you said.
The 11 universal laws.
Just search for the 11 forgotten laws. That's all you need to do. Yes, my friend.
That's
so
awesome.
I'm going to show you guys a couple books I just bought recently. I think this will be...
Also, I was going to say one thing, too, that even though, okay, we don't have a whole lot of viewers right now, but the YouTube time for watching is over like 500 or 600. So someone put a lot of time into watching our stuff when we're not here. So it is coming back.
It will.
There are people who are watching our stuff. There's someone who's been watching our stuff. I know I haven't been sitting there for 500 minutes and just been watching broadcast. That'd be kind of weird.
Anyway, this is a book you all need to get if you don't have it yet.
Law of Success
by Napoleon Hill. I actually have read. This one only costed me $20. You can find this pretty much anywhere that's got books. If it's a bookstore, you can find stuff by Napoleon Hill. And I also he's got Think and Grow Rich. Yeah.
Look right here. How come yours is bigger, though? What's up with that?
Because this
looks like a Bible.
That's Think and Grow Rich. This is the Law of Success. Those both of those books go together.
Yeah.
Yeah. This one is, oh boy, 600 pages.
600?
Yeah. Oh, wow. So I got a pretty heavy read there. And then this book I got is part of the course we're going to be taking that we've talked about. This is Pay Me What I'm Worth by Soul Dancer. And we're going to be starting this course when Marsha Sortino gets enough students. So this is, I actually haven't read this yet, most of it, because we're supposed to wait until the course starts to start actually reading this and doing the exercises. But I'm really excited about this, and Soul Dancers, right there in that picture, he's an incredible person.
It's his real name.
It's his real name. Soul Dancer is the founder of Soul Dancing. Soul Dancer invites you to enjoy life without guilt, shame, worry, or fear. Soul Dancer balances learning with teaching, both personally as well as with his clients. He's a published author, internationally recognized keynote speaker, and radio show host. So, I mean, his wisdom flows from travels to 30 different countries, along with 2 decades of diverse spiritual studies and teachings. He earned a University of Minnesota undergraduate degree in human relationships and master's in social work. He's also a monk and a spiritual practitioner. So I'm really excited to keep talking with this guy. And he's been on our show once already, and we love Soul Dancer. He's a great guy, and definitely somebody that I want to follow and be inspired by. So I hope you guys will too. And yeah, so those are 2 books that I'm really excited about getting into more. So
this is the one I still go back to. I love this book.
I got to get that.
Wait, what does that say? I can't see it on the screen.
Awaken the Giant Within by Tony Robbins.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice. You finished it?
I have gone through, I have a little bit more to go through, but the majority, yes. Actually, I know it's not a movie, but it talks about a story, one that's real powerful, of 2 brothers had an abusive dad. And he was an alcoholic. He didn't treat him very well. And one brother did the exact same thing. And another brother went married, got half kids, and went on a better path. When they asked them, why did you choose what you did? They said, I couldn't have seen doing things any other way. Wow. So, to me, it goes to show you that if you change your perspective on how things are, whether it's from a book, a movie, a speech, a YouTube video, you can. Like this little hangout, someone used it on YouTube, it could change their whole life. It could change their whole perspective on things. It'd be like, I was afraid to start my own business, but I saw Kareem, Chris, and Kuba, Doug, and Andrew, and they all seem pretty cool.
His first name's Chrysler, Kareem.
It's all good.
Kuba. We're going to start calling you Cuban. Cuban, man. Cuban. You need a big
Chrysler.
You need a big cigar blunt there, man. That'd be awesome.
Nah. That's back in the young days. We grown now.
We grown. Yeah, I'm old.
Kareem's 21. Old. Frick.
You guys got to stop talking old, okay?
Poor Doug.
Yo, if I'm old and Kareem is old, Lord have mercy.
I don't know, man.
We're all young. We're all youngsters.
Yeah.
We have a young spirit. Yeah. We're all very refreshed. I think old is really
I went over the hill at 19, but I'm going for a wild ride down, I'll tell you what.
There you go.
Oh, boy.
It is.
Awesome. Yeah.
We could actually do the next show on like how age has changed your perspective on your business.
No, here's the thing though, Kareem. We want to keep it so that yes, we want to talk about business, but I don't think we should make that the center focus of the show.
Or how age has changed your perspective on life.
Life. Because, you know, network marketers come on here, if they've been burned out all day by absorbing information on whatever they're doing and they're really burned out on personal development, they want a place where they can just come relax, laugh, and be entertained and interact. And that's what we're going to start. That's what we're going to do with this from now on. Because Marsha's a brilliant mentor for me and Kareem, and she makes a lot of good points, and I want to follow her lead because she only wants what's best for the show. So I think that we got to give her a lot of credit, and I wish she was here tonight, because without her this wouldn't be possible, because she put this idea in my head quite a while ago, actually about 6 months ago, to start a YouTube show, and then me and Kareem did a lot of brainstorming on this and came up with this. So, you know, we really owe Marsha a lot of credit for that.
Yeah. Definitely. It's only going to grow. It's only going to grow, and I'm going to make sure of that.
Yeah.
And it's honestly here to have fun. Like, I'm having fun. I'm not looking at
you also look like you're in the Bat Cave right now. You should turn a light on, Kareem.
I'm trying.
Look, what are you trying to hide over there?
He's trying to obscure himself, like, that should be more like me, man. I'm the one that should have no lights on right now, you know, but I'm proud
it's just
of my
hot. It's hot
I'm proud of my Slipknot flags. This is my favorite band.
Why is your room so bright, Chris?
Hey?
Why is your room so bright?
Because I have look at like, the light I've got. I'll show you the
everything. Lord, you can't even, that's the sun right there. How'd you get the sun inside your room?
That is actually an energy-efficient coil light that is only 15 watts, but it's energy-efficient.
Worst idea.
What'd you say, Doug?
Yeah, those energy-efficient balls.
It is.
Those energy-efficient balls were the worst idea ever, though.
No, they're not. They're only 13 watts, man. They're incredible, and they last, like, so long, too.
Yeah, you know, you need by law, you need a hazardous waste crew come in and clean it up if you break it.
No, there's not a lot of mercury in them, Doug. There really isn't that much mercury in them. Because they are neon. That's what they are. They're neon.
That's different. Okay.
What if you put tuna in them? Would there be a lot of mercury in them?
Sometimes I just want to reek through the screen and smack him upside the head.
He's an idea man. Leave him alone.
Yeah.
He's an idea man. Tuna lights.
Andrew, you're sitting over there quiet. What's up, man?
Nothing. Just listening.
He's
getting shot. It's late.
It's late. Yeah, we know, buddy. Thanks for being here, by the way. And we're gonna make it at least 4 o'clock for your convenience, so that you're not up super super late. So thank you so much, man. We appreciate you coming.
Where are you at, Andrew?
Spain.
Huh? In Spain?
Yeah. What time is it over there?
That's one place I didn't get to when I was in Europe. It's
10 to 1.
So it's already Sunday morning there for him.
Wow.
Yes, that's on my bucket list, because I never made it to Spain when I was in Europe.
Where have you been?
Austria, Germany, Holland. Didn't make it to Italy or Spain. That's the two that I really wanted to see that I'd make it to.
Have you been to Belgium yet?
No. Oh. No, just Holland and Austria and Germany.
Oh, okay.
You guys should visit Norway. That's where I'm from.
And Belgium.
That's and Belgium. Belgium and Norway. Yeah, beautiful.
Is there a Ukraine nice to go to now, too?
Yeah, I've been to the Ukraine quite a few times, too.
Not necessarily a good place to go right now.
No, but...
Oh, my God.
Honey, we're going to Ukraine.
Really?
We should go shoot a movie in Ukraine.
Hey, Doug, I see a collection of books behind you on your shelf there, Doug. What do you got over there?
Yeah.
Oh, man, a little bit of everything.
Cool.
A lot of Stephen King.
Oh, I love Stephen King. Brilliant author.
I've got a lot of biographies. I do a lot. I like reading about real historical people. Like, I don't know. I had one on Chrysler and one on Iacocca, one on Bush, one on Clinton. I don't know. A few others in there. I can't remember what's all there. A lot of science fiction.
Where are you from, Doug?
Originally, I'm from Baltimore.
But where are you now? You have a southern. You have kind of a Texan accent. Are you Texan?
I'm in Norman, Oklahoma, is where I
live. Oh, Oklahoma. Okay.
Mine's kind of a mix of everywhere though, because I moved all over the country when I was young.
Right.
Just stayed everywhere. I just kind of never settled in. But I lived here like 7 different times now. So.
Okay.
This is home.
He's a 50-stater.
He's a Heinz 57. There you go.
42, I think, is what I figured up.
Heinz 42. All right, so I'll go to Norway and I'll show them my music taste, and I think they'll appreciate it.
you're playing with fire on that one, Kareem.
I didn't start the fire. It was always burning.
No, but Norway sure did. Norway started a lot of fires.
Oh, boy. I don't want to get into that.
Oh, it's a topic for another time, for sure. Yeah.
Okay.
Guys, I'm going to call it a night.
Okay, buddy. You have a great night, and we'll see you next week, buddy.
Nice to meet you. Thanks for coming, man.
Good night, Andrew. Sleep well.
You too.
Later, dude.
Later.
America.
So, what else do you guys want to talk about? Should we end the show and then just...
Hold on. Before we get off here, Kuba, Chrysler, I've never met you before. Where are you from? I know you're from Belgium. Are you still living there?
Oh, no, I'm currently in Atlanta, Georgia right now.
Atlanta, okay.
Yeah, I've lived here since I came to America, really. About 12 years now. That's why the accent's completely gone.
Just about, yeah.
it is a little bit there, I guess. But, yeah, so Gwinnett County, ATL. And what else interesting about it? I'm actually 21. I'm the youngest guy in here, so don't feel too old.
You've been in Georgia about that time?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't go out much, honestly. I mean, I got to go to Vegas and Dallas, you know, for school, for some things we were doing, for fundraising and stuff. That was exciting. Been to Virginia. I've been to, what else have I been to? North Carolina for like 3 days, so I didn't really feel like I was anywhere, just to visit family and stuff. I went to, they have nice mountains, but, you know, you got to go out and do stuff. I was just in the house all day.
I admire your mission work. That's awesome.
Thank you. I really appreciate it.
Cool. You
know, one day at a time, one day at a time. Been to D.C. That was fun.
I was there when I was real little. My dad was doing some physics conference, and I think I just actually said he wanted to go to museums, but I wouldn't stop crying and being annoying, so he couldn't go. Where have I been? I'm from America. I believe that's how it's pronounced.
America.
No, America. You are from Cairo. Kareem.
Okay, now I was born in Rhode Island, and then my dad. Now I live in PA, but I've been to Cairo, I've been to Mexico, I've been to Britain. So I've been around. I didn't go to St. Britain for long though, but I have family in Egypt. Actually, most of my family's in Egypt, and I found out I had some relatives in Australia and Canada, so I might hit up there and one in Georgia. So maybe I'll see you around.
I have a lot of family in Canada, like right now. That was actually one of my plans, to go to Canada, live there for a while.
Well, you guys can all come chill out with me, man.
But no, it's too cold.
What are you talking
about? It's too cold, oh, you pansies.
Well, I have to learn. Well, I have to learn my alphabet from A to Z.
Yeah, even my older sister, I don't know how, man. She moved up there and she was 18 to go to school. Now she still lives there. But now she has an accent. I don't know what happened. I don't know what you guys did to her up there.
What are you doing?
It's a nice place, though.
We didn't do nothing.
The accent is... I don't know. She sounds like a different person.
Wait, Chrysler, what are you talking about?
I don't say that. I say about...
She goes, okay. Yeah, that's how you talk, baby. Like, about. Everybody hey, shout
what are you talking nobody about says about, hey. Kareem. I don't know what kind of crack you're smoking, but nobody says about.
It's the medicine, man. It's the medicine. The Tylenol and the prescription that you can't hardly read.
Hey,
it's all that, man.
Scramble his brain.
Yeah, it's popular down here.
You might say a boot in the mountains of Minnesota.
Like, so you're from Canada, eh?
Yeah, we say A, that's for sure.
Nah, like
the official currency is Monopoly money. So you'd be very
our dollar's worth more than yours, buddy. Right now it is anyway.
I think we should end the hangout though.
Yeah. It was fun. This was an awesome hangout, man.
Alright, I'll stop it. All right, everybody. So I'm.